I'm joined today by Peter Heslin. Peter is an associate professor in the School of Management at the Australian School of Business, and Peter is an expert in the area of values, decision-making, goals. Peter, thank you very much for joining me today.
My pleasure.
Peter, can you tell us some of the latest thinking and groundbreaking research that's happening in the context of values, decision-making, and or goal setting?
Goal setting is one of the most useful motivational implications theories we've got. So if you really want to help someone, you get them to set a goal. Research has taught us a lot about the characteristics of good goals. So you've got to be specific. You want to be challenging. You want to make sure that people are highly committed to their goals. But even when these things seem to be in place, goals are often not achieved. So think about typical New Year's resolutions. Every year, many people set New Year's resolutions. They sign up for gyms and all this sort of stuff. But then we see that a month or two later, it's all gone to seed. The goal wasn't implemented on any sustainable basis. So the latest research has really tried to say, besides having a well-set goal, what could build commitment to it and assist with its implementation? And there's been some great research on this out of New York University. First of all, there's a concept called mental contrasting, developed by Gabrielle Oettinger. And the way this works is one takes the concept of what you want to achieve and contrasts it with your current state of affairs. And mental contrasting is the alternatives to either indulging, which is thinking a lot about where you'd like to end up. So I'd like to be this certain weight, or I'd like to be this certain genius. So that's indulging. Or dwelling, which is focusing only on where you are now, as opposed to where it is you'd like to be. Where mental contrasting comes in is it says, think about where you want to be, then think about where you are now. Then think about where you want to be, then think about where you are now. So one of Oettinger's studies had people who'd enrolled in a computing science course. And they were eager to excel in maths, which is a very important part of computing science. And what she had them do is, for the indulging group, elaborate on four reasons why you'd like to be excellent at maths. For the dwelling group, think about four reasons why you'd like to, you know, what holds you back from being excellent. And for the mental contrasting, they elaborated on why they'd like to be good, what stops them from being good. So why they'd like to be good, it will help my job prospects. What holds them back? Well, I might get distracted with my friends. Why would you like to be good? Because it's fun to be able to solve interesting problems. What will hold you back? I'm not very organized. By focusing, alternating back and forth between where they wanted to be and what was holding them back, they were significantly more energized, they persisted more, and they got much better grades in their courses. So all the people in this study wanted to do well, but by just getting that patterning of focus between where they wanted to end up and where they were now, people did much better. So that's mental contrasting. The idea of implementation intentions, and this is Peter Gollwitz's work, it says it's good and well to have a well-set goal, and the goal says what you will want to achieve, but when exactly you're going to go and achieve it. So a fascinating study he conducted was, he said, perhaps a bit mercilessly to some students, I'll give you extra credit if on Boxing Day you send me a report on what you did on Christmas Day. Nearly all of his students said they would send that report. Most of them did not send the report. However, for half of his students, he said, what I want you to do is write down exactly when and where you're going to write that report on Boxing Day. For those who did it, 75% of them did their report. For those who didn't write down when and where they would pursue their goal, only 33% of it did, so less than half. So we want to combine both a goal with a statement of when and where we'll do it, which is the implementation intention.
And Peter, what are some of the practical implications for managers and leaders of some of the concepts that you talked about that are covered in this unit?
Well, mental contrasting has been shown to work in a whole range of different areas, whether it be people wanting to study or work abroad, whether it be acquiring a second language, which is a good thing to do in our times of global careers, getting to know attractive strangers, finding a balance between work and life, which is something that most of us need to do, even reducing cigarette consumption, if that's something you still do. So an important thing to keep in mind if you want to engage in mental contrasting is, first of all, you've got to be able to believe that you can do it. Fortunately, we have very well-developed technology around developing our self-efficacy, our belief we could do a particular thing. In brief, the three steps are, first of all, we want to engage in some small steps, so we experience some initial successes before we then take on larger challenges. So for example, if you want to develop your public speaking ability, first practice alone, practice with a supportive friend, so practice with a few people and then you develop up to greater challenges. Second, get a role model. Watch other people, see what they do, and build your imagine yourself doing it, and this builds confidence. And the other one is, think about your self-talk. Make sure that you're encouraging yourself and not running you down, and preferably getting someone else to encourage you to do the things that you want to do. And then after you've got your self-efficacy in place, you want to go back to that mental contrasting concept that I talked about. In the realm of implementation intentions, these are terrifically important because some goals are imperative to be achieved. For example, imagine you've just had a knee operation, and I know my mother had a few years ago. Your bones are sawed off, a hinge is put in there. It's incredibly painful. But what happens is, if you don't engage in the required exercise on the schedule that's given for you, you can have atrophy around tendons, which means that your medium to long-term recovery will take a lot longer, and you may indeed never walk again properly. You may never recover full mobility. So you must stay on the program. So it's all good and well to say, well, my goal is to do this much exercise in the week. Instead, implementation intentions will say, at 12 o'clock I'll do this. Not sometime between 12 and 6, at 12 o'clock this, at 3 o'clock that, at 6 o'clock the other. So it's exactly when this time occurs, here's what I'll do. I've also found personally implementation intentions useful when I go to conferences. When I get on the plane, the moment they say, now you can turn on electronic equipment, I take out my notebook, type up my notes. If I don't do it then, I'm never going to do it. So we build in a cue for ourselves. It's kind of like Pavlovian dog. You hear the bell, you can turn on things, you react. Some people resist, feeling like they're a robot that responds to the cue, but in fact, you get to set the cue. No one gives you implementation intentions. You set them for yourself, and they're a powerful resource to help you actually achieve your objectives. One other one that people often enjoy setting is, when I get home, I'll speak with my spouse for at least 15 minutes before I turn on the television. I've personally found that to be a useful one to adopt.
Peter, thank you very much for speaking with me today.
My pleasure.